3. So we have 3 loops or 3 meshes here in the given network. Now here, where is a super mesh? So for that, you first identify the current source. So here is the current source. What do you observe secondly about this current source? That this current source is common to loop 1 and is also common to loop 2. So this current source is common current source, right? And it is between 2 adjacent loops. 2 loops which are closer to each other are sharing 1 common current source. Therefore, loop 1 and loop 2 form a super mesh. This is what is the meaning of super mesh. Right, so loop 1 and loop 2 are super mesh. Once you identify the super mesh, how would you apply KVL? KVL is not applied to loop 1 and loop 2 independently. Instead, once we identify the super mesh, KVL has to be applied to super mesh. It means that KVL has to be applied to the combined loop which is generated by combining loop 1 and loop 2. It means that when I'll now apply KVL, KVL is applied to this particular loop which is obtained by combining loop 1 and loop 2. So this forms my super mesh, and this is the path on which I'll be applying KVL. I will not be applying KVL to loop 1 and loop 2 independently anymore. I'll be applying KVL to this closed circuit which is formed by combining loop 1 and loop 2, which we call as the super mesh. So this particular closed loop is the super mesh. Is that clear? That is the only difference between mesh analysis and super mesh analysis. So in super mesh analysis, first you identify the current source. Once you identify the current source, see whether that current source is common to some loops, two adjacent loops. If the current source is common to two loops, then the two loops combine to form a super mesh. So my super mesh is this larger loop which is formed by combining loop 1 and loop 2. Is that clear? So now we'll solve certain problems which are based on super mesh analysis. So here's a problem given to you. The currents are I1, I2, I3 and I4. We have to find the currents I1, I2, I3, I4. Okay, I have shown the currents in the lower figure here. These are the currents which we have to find. Current I1, I2, I3, I4. This is the problem. Right? So, as we just said, first analyze the circuit. Don't haste to solve the problem. First, you take a minute to analyze your given circuit carefully. See what all are the components involved there. Right? The very first is my independent source, which is 6 volt. I identify one more independent source, which is a current source of 40 amperes. Right? And then I identify one independent source. There is one independent source we have identified. Now check whether this independent source is a current source or a voltage source. Look at the symbol. The symbol helps you to identify the independent source. So the symbol here is for a current source. So this is a dependent current source. Now see what is the value assigned to this current source. It is 5 Vx. It is 5 Vx. It means that it is voltage controlled current source, because it is a function of some voltage. That's why you call it to be voltage controlled current source. Now somewhere there must be Vx present in the network, right? Because dependent sources are dependent on the currents and the voltages in the network. So Vx must be part of the network. So where is Vx? So if you see here is Vx. Now they have assigned the polarities also. Clearly we understand that Vx is the voltage across 0.2 ohm resistor. So voltage across this resistor is Vx, and this current source is a function of this voltage Vx. This is what we identified. So once we analyze the circuit, now the next thing is, before we apply the KVLs, let us identify whether there is some super mesh present here. Yes, for that what you have to do is you have to identify your current source. So here is your current source. Is this current source common between two loops? Yes, this current source is common to loop 2 and loop 3. So loop 2 and loop 3 is forming a super mesh. So when we apply KVL, we will not be applying KVL to loop 2 and loop 3 independently. Instead, what we will be doing is we will applying KVL to the super mesh, that is the combination of these two. So we will be applying KVL to this super mesh, right? Okay. Now before starting with KVL, let us see whether we can get some values from the circuit itself. What are the values we are going to get? So as we just said, right, loop 2 and loop 3, as we just discussed, are forming super mesh. Now see what values you get from the circuit before you start to apply KVL. Look, there is a current source here, right? So there is the current which flows through this branch, we have assigned the current as I4. So we can directly say that I4 is the branch in this current, which is nothing but the current source, equivalent to the current source. So I4 takes a value of 40 amperes because 40 amperes is the current flowing in this branch. We have assigned the current to this branch as I4, and therefore I4 takes a value of 40 amperes. So directly we have obtained one of the current from the figure itself, that is I4 is 40. Now the next thing, let us look at Vx. It's a current source. So current is in the upward direction. What are the currents flowing in this particular branch? The current flowing in this branch are I2 and I3, right? The two currents which flow in this branch are I2 and I3. Now following the direction of the current source, we are in the upward direction, right? So current in the upward direction is I3. So overall, how would you relate this particular current source with the currents flowing in that branch? So this particular current source is nothing but I3 minus I2. Why is it I3 minus I2? Because the current source has a direction which is upward. The current which is flowing in the upward direction is I3, and hence I3 should be taken positive, I2 should be taken negative. So the current in this particular branch becomes I3 minus I2, which is nothing but the current source, which is 5Vx. And hence we get one more equation here, that 5Vx is nothing but I3 minus I2. Now check what is your Vx. Vx is nothing but the voltage across 0.2 resistor, 0.2 ohm resistor, right? So formulate an equation for Vx. So Vx is nothing but, if I apply Ohm's law, V is equal to IR. What is the current in this particular branch? There are two currents in this particular branch flowing through 0.2 ohms. The currents are I1 and I2. So two currents flowing from this branch. Now look at the polarity of Vx, which is mentioned in the network. It is positive to negative. It means that the current is flowing in the upward direction. So which is the current which flows in the upward direction is I2. So I2 becomes the main current, I1 becomes the secondary current here. And therefore, your Vx is nothing but 0.2 into I2 minus I1. Correct? Because the polarity given in the network is plus here and minus here. And that's why the current in the Vx is in the upward direction, right? And that's why the current here is nothing but, the voltage here is nothing but I2 minus I1. Right, so Vx is nothing but 0.2 into I2 minus I1, correct? And once we have analyzed the complete circuit, now we have to go and apply the KVLs to the mesh. Regular procedure, now the procedure is to apply KVL the way we have done it for mesh analysis. Right, so let us start by applying KVL to mesh 1, so this one. So decide some reference point. So let us start with the voltage in the independent source. So independent source is having a polarity upward negative, lower positive. So when we move in this particular direction, we are going through a fall in the potential, right? So it is minus 6. Then I come to 0.1 ohm resistor. So it is minus 0.1 into what is the current here? I1. When I come to this particular branch, what is the current flowing through this particular branch? Now it is two currents I1, I2, we are following this particular direction, and hence the current now has to be taken as I1 minus I2 because we are in loop 1. I1 is primary current here. So I1 minus I2, so minus 0.2, I1 minus I2. When I come to this particular branch, again there are two currents here. Which are the two currents? I1 and I4 this time. Right, so what will be the equation here? Minus 0.16 I1 minus I4, because as we are in loop 1, I1 is the main current we are focusing on. So I1 minus I4 is the current here, and then the loop terminates to the point and equated to 0. So when we put all the things together, this is the equation that we have got. Minus 6 minus 0.1 0.1 I1 minus 0.2 here, minus 0.2 I1 minus I2 minus 0.16 I1 minus I4 equated to 0. Now you know I4, so you can substitute I4 in that equation here. Substitute your I4, right? And then you get an equation which is in terms of I1 and I2, right? So I4 is already known to us, right? So I4 value is known to us. When I substitute I4 as 40, I get an equation which is this. So I'll call this as equation 1. Right. Now this is for loop 1. The next step, what we do is apply KVL to super mesh. This is important. Apply KVL to super mesh. Super mesh means what here? The mesh which is formed by combining loop 2 and loop 3. So here this particular loop is my super mesh. So we are going to apply KVL to this particular super mesh, and that's why the statement says applying KVL to super mesh. What is super mesh? Combination of loop 2 and loop 3, because there is a current source common to these two, it's forming a super mesh. So start formulating with some reference point, starting point. So let me say if I start with from here, what do I get? I get the equation as minus 0.05. What is the current in this particular branch? Only I2. So minus 0.05 I2 minus 0.066 into the current in this particular branch is I3. Then I come here. It is minus 0.5. What is the current in this particular branch? Now I see there are two currents. The two currents are I3 and I4. So minus 0.5 I3 minus I4. Then I come to this particular point here, right? Point 2, what are the currents here? There are two currents again, I1, I2. So substitute it. So minus 0.2, this time I2 minus I1, because I2 is the main current. So I2 minus I1, right? So when I substitute all this, right? Let us check what equation we have got is this. Minus 0.5, minus 0.05, I2. Then minus 0.066 I3, it is this point. Then the next equation is minus 0.5 I3 minus I4. It is this particular point we are talking about. Then we come to 0.2 minus 0.2 I2 minus I1 equated to 0. Now out of this entire equation, what values we know? We know the value of I4. So if you see here, I4 is substituted for you, right? So when we substitute I4, right, the equation which comes out to be is this, with three unknown terms, I2, I3, I1. As I4 was known, we substituted I4, which was 40 amperes. We substituted 40 and we got here as minus 20. Now the thing is, we have two equations. Equation 1, which is having two variables I1, I2. And equation 2, which has having three variables I2, I3 and I1. So I cannot solve 1 and 2 using simultaneous equation. We need to reduce one of the variables here. Right, so for that, we will take the help of the analysis that we had done at the start about Vx. So we know that Vx was, 5Vx was I3 minus I2 that we had discussed at the beginning. Right, and we have one more equation of Vx, which was 0.2 I2 minus I1. So using these two equations that we had discussed at the start, we can get some equation for I3, and that's what is being done here. Right, so we substituted vx. So 5 into vx, vx was this. So we substituted vx into this equation, right? So we got a relation between I1, I2, I3 and I2, right? So when we substitute, multiply, 5 was multiplied, we got an equation for I3. I2 got cancelled here, I2 got added here, and we got an equation for I3, which is 2I2 minus I1. Right, so using the relation that we had discussed at the start, we got an equation for I3. So what we need to do now, we have to substitute this I3 into equation 2 so that we reduce this equation only with two variables, I2 and I1. Once I reduce this equation with variables I2 and I1, I have an equation which is similar to an equation which is a function of I1 and I2, and then I can apply simultaneous equation, and that's what is being done here. We substituted the current I3 into equation 2, so we replaced here I3 by the equation we had just deduced, right? Simplified it, so we got a new equation which is in terms of I2 and I1. We named it as equation 3. So now you closely look at your equation 1 and equation 3. So equation 1 is a function of I1 and I2. Equation 3 is also a function of I1 and I2. So we can now apply simultaneous equations to equation 1 and 3. And then we do that and we get the currents I1, I2, I3, I4, which is what we had already found at the very start. So we get the currents I1 to be 9.43, I2 to be 19.70, that is closer to 20 amperes, I3 is approximately 30 amperes, and I4 is 40 amperes. So this is how you solve the problems on super mesh analysis, right? Let us solve one more problem on super mesh analysis so that we get good confidence of identifying the super mesh analysis. So the problem here says identify or find the currents I1 and I2. The problem says find the currents I1 and I2. The I1 and I2 currents are mentioned to you in the problem, right? So what is the very first thing that we do? We analyze the given network. Look at what are the types of sources. So what are the sources here? The source here is 110 volts, independent source, right? There is only one independent source here, right? And there is one dependent source. There is one dependent source. Look at the symbol here. The symbol is an arrow which indicates that it's a current source. So, right? It's a current source. What is a parameter associated with it? It is 0.5V1. It means that it's a voltage controlled current source. Right? So V1 must be present in the network. So where is V1? V1 is here. So V1 is the voltage across 2 ohm resistor, right? So this is how we analyze the given circuit. We identified the sources, we saw the relation of them, right? And then now before we start solving, let us identify the loops. What are the loops present here? How many loops are there? How many meshes are there? There are 3 meshes, mesh 1, mesh 2 and mesh 3. There are 3 meshes. Now see whether the current source, the moment the current source is identified, we would see whether the current source is common between two loops. Yes, we identify such loops. Where are they? We see that this current source is common to loop 2 and loop 3. Right? Mesh 2 and mesh 3, this current source is common. And therefore, mesh 2 and mesh 3 forms a super mesh. So these two loops combine and form a super mesh. The moment it forms a super mesh, we will be applying KVL to the super mesh. We will not be applying KVL to loop 2 and loop 3 independently. Instead, we will be applying KVL to the combined loops formed by combining I3 and I3. By the loops 2 and loop 3. Where is that loop which is formed by combination? Is this. This is the path. Right? When I combine the two loops, I get this path. So I'll be applying KVL to the super mesh, which is a combination of loop 2 and loop 3. Right? So let's start solving the problem now. So First, you see before you start to analyze whether you can identify few things from the circuit itself, right? The moment there is a current source, right? Can this current source be value of sum of the network current? Yes. So if you see here, I3 which flows through this branch, I3 flows through this particular branch. So I3 directly takes the value of the current. I3 takes the value of the current source. So what is the value of I3 here? I3 takes the value of the current source which is flowing. But is I3 the only current here? No. What are the current which flows through that branch? There are two currents. Which are they? I3 and I2. Right. So I3 is not only that current. So this current has to be assigned to the currents which flow through that branch, and hence the currents which flow through this branch which we identified are two currents, I2 and I3. Look at the direction of the current source. It is in this particular direction. Which current flows in this particular direction is I3. So how do you formulate that? It will be this 0.5V1, the current source, must be equal to I3 minus I2. Correct? This particular current source must be subtraction of I3 minus I2, not I2 minus I1. Why? Look at the direction of the current source. It is in this particular direction. Which current flows in this direction is I3. So it becomes I3 minus I2. So understanding this, if we put it, we understood that 0.5V1, that is this current source, is subtraction of I3 minus I2. This is one equation we got. Now look at the other equation of V1. What is V1? V1 is the voltage across 2 ohm resistor. What are the polarities given to us? It is positive and negative. That will help us to formulate the equation of V1. So V1 is nothing but, if I apply Ohm's law, V is equal to IR. What is the current in this particular branch? The current in these two, in this particular branch, are two currents, I1 and I2. Right? So what is the value of V1 then? So if it is positive here, if it is negative here, it means that the current flows in this direction. It means that V1 must be equal to 2 into I1 minus I2. Right? So V1 is 2 into I1 minus I2. So two equations we got before we applied KVL, friends. Two equations we have obtained. One is V1 is 2 into I1 minus I2, and another equation was 0.5V1 is I3 minus I2. Right? So we can solve this. Right? I substituted V1 here. Right? So 0.5 into 2 into I1 minus I2 is equal to I3 minus I2. So when I simplified this, what we observed, that one of the current has been cancelled out here, right? And we get I2 gets cancelled, right? So you see here, I2 gets cancelled. So I1 is nothing but equal to I3, right? So we obtain one of the current directly by the analysis from the figure itself before we applied KVL. So I1 is equal to I3. Now we will start to apply KVL to find the remaining currents of interest. So we'll start by applying KVL to mesh 1. That is this. We'll apply KVL to mesh 1. Right? So what will be the equation? If I start with this particular current source, so it will be 110 minus 14I1 minus 4I1 minus 2 into, right? As we are in loop 1, it will be I1 minus I2 minus 2 into I1 minus I2 is equal to 0. So here we have got the equation, right? And then when we simplify this, we get an equation in a form which is dependent on two currents, unknown currents, I1 and I2. So this is the equation which is formulated by applying KVL to loop 1. Now we will apply KVL to super mesh. Now we will look at the super mesh, right? So these two loops are combined to form the super mesh because there is a current source which is common between them. So what is my super mesh? Is this 10 ohm resistor, 6 ohm resistor and 2 ohm resistor. This forms my super mesh, which is formed by combining these two loops. So start from any point, apply KVL now to the super mesh. So I'll start with the 10 ohm resistor. So minus 10 into, what is the current here? I3 minus 10 I3. Minus 6, what is the current here? Is only I2, so minus 6 I2, and I come to this 2 ohm resistor minus 2 into, what are the currents? The currents are 2 currents here, I1 and I2 both. So 2 minus 2 into I2 minus I1 and then equated to 0. So this is how you formulated your KVL, right? You get this equation. What we know, we have already obtained that I3 is nothing but I1. So let us substitute that I3 is equal to I1 in the equation if I need it. Yes, I have an I3 here. So I'll substitute I3 as I1. So I get an equation which is only a function of I1 and I2. What we observe here, we get an equation that minus 8 I1 is equal to minus 8 I2 when we simplify it. Simply I1 turns out to be minus I2. Right, so we'll substitute this relation in equation 1. We'll replace I1 as minus I2. So we get an equation which is only having variable I2, from which we will calculate I2. So I2 is minus 5 amperes and I1, which is nothing but minus of I2, turns out to be 5 amperes. So this is how we have applied KVL to super mesh. So I hope the concept of super mesh is now very, very clear to you, right? Super mesh is formed by combining the mesh where the current source is common.